defensively, they fought really hard. They played really well at times. And then special teams, something that we were really good at week one. We made some poor decisions on special teams. But saying all that, this group has been fantastic to coach. The response to tough situations this year has been everything a coach could ask for. And yesterday, although painful, was the response by the coaches and players was what I thought was appropriate for moving on. So, you know, we flushed it. It's time to move on, and we have a great challenge ahead of us with Arkansas. So we know the battle ahead, and we're prepared to fight it.
You say you flushed it, but how difficult was it to flush it on, you know, Saturday night on the ride home and you know, Sunday before you kind of went to work on flushing it?
Well, I think, you know, I got asked. I have a lot of phone calls, people calling, reaching out, and as well as talking to people in the building. And I've been asked, like, where does this fit in your losses? I'm like, I mean, it's up there. It's one of the more painful ones. But I also look back at a lot of the most painful setbacks of my football career, and if handled the right way, there's good things that come out of the other end. I think where they snowball is if you handle them in the wrong manner. And my message to the team, message to the coaches, message to myself was, let's not forget what matters most in life, and that's relationships. And don't let something bad that happens to you affect the relationships in your life. And the relationships that are important right now are the relationships in this building. And we won't be in a position where we're going to start jeopardizing the relationships that we work so hard on because of a tremendous setback like that. That just doesn't fit with how we're wired.
And Trent, looking at the offensive line's performance Saturday, what do you think, after analyzing the film, was it ULM doing stunts, or was it more just lack of communication up front?
Well, and this is, you know, this is a myth buster. I've dealt with this forever. Anytime you're struggling pass protection, people want to say it's the offensive line. And they had their culpability, but so did Jacob. And so did our backs, and so did our receivers. Pass protection is an 11-person process. And when one of those pieces doesn't do their job, it exasperates what it looks like is only the offensive line's job. So did we get beat on some stunts? Yeah. Did we get beat on some bull rushes? Yeah. But we also didn't handle the pocket very well when there was a pocket. We also weren't fast by the receivers on some quick look throws that could have gotten the ball out. Our running backs were not sound in protection. You know, they're part of, you know, a lot of our protection schemes are six-man protection schemes. So it's five offensive linemen and a back or a tight end. And it takes the sixth guy to do his job. And there were many plays with offensive line. They did their job. They did the five-man job. And the sixth person did not. We have five-man protection schemes where the wide receiver and the quarterback are responsible for the sixth guy. And the sixth guy got us, wasn't the five guys. So I would hope that, you know, when we're criticized, which we deserve all the criticism in the world, but let's be fair with the criticism. We all stunk. Trent stunk. Mort stunk. The back stunk, the quarterback stunk, and the offensive line stunk. You know, so we're all equally culpable in that disaster offensively. And that, I think that is what's cool about this group, is that I didn't have to tell them that. You know, like, that was obvious yesterday as we watched the film, as, okay, we know what happened. We're all bad. So let's not say one group was worse than the other. Because now you start getting... that starts damaging relationships, because these kids aren't dumb. They know, well, I did my job there. Why am I getting criticized? And when it's like, we all own this, we all got to sit in this, then you can move forward when you know you're all equally culpable.
You know, the mental game is half the battle in this sport. How do you keep
a young team like this, especially the offense, confident in their abilities going into a game in an environment like Arkansas?
Yeah, I think that's the challenge. It's a great question. It's exactly what my challenge is how do you not let a massive setback derail a positive trajectory? And I think in life, you know, our players did a really cool exercise this summer called Mountains and Valleys. So we went through our lives as a building and talked about the mountaintop experiences we've had and the valley experiences we've had. And it was hard for some because some don't want to own the valleys because it's too painful, right? It's too painful. All of us have the scars in our lives from the valleys that we go through. And what we've learned is that by going through, by talking about those valleys, by being supported through those valleys, you end up, you have a better opportunity of not repeating those valleys. The reason I tell you that is football is the same way. You have mountains and valleys. You have mountains and valleys on each side of the ball. And offensively, I would even call week one a valley. You know, we have not played well offensively in two games. So we're in a valley. But that doesn't mean there's not a mountain coming. And we, through the off season, we were trending for a lot of mountains. So let's not forget that we're going to be a mountain offense. Let's see how quickly we can get to the top while we're in the valley. And I know we're going to play well offensively. I don't know when, right? But I know we're going to. And I trust these players, and I trust our coaches. And there's some things that are alarming in our time here that we have to go to work at fixing. But at least we're aware of them, and we're not. Here's the easiest way of saying it. We're not turning a blind eye to our flaws. We're recognizing our flaws, and we're going to work at fixing them.
With the offense, you know, coming into the season, you know, before these 2 weeks of you know, getting in the valley, did you see some problems, you know, or did you think you'd be in a different spot right now after 2 weeks offensively?
I saw some danger rangers, is what I call them. Some things that if we, you know, didn't continue to work on, that could get us in trouble. We still worked on them, maybe not with the urgency. You know, I think what happens when you're successful, when you've had some success, and I wouldn't call our success offensively like monumental, but we've been for the most part pretty successful offensively, that the sense of urgency to fix your flaws isn't always there, and until they're fully exposed. And I thought they were fully exposed Saturday night. So, you know, hopefully that'll create more sense of urgency. I would hope that it doesn't take something like that again moving forward. But in my experience in football, that's usually what it takes, unfortunately. So, there were some things that we had gotten away with, I would say. And we didn't get away with them Saturday night, and I give Ernest Hill a tremendous amount of credit that he did some things that he knew. Like I told you guys this last week, they know, right? They just knew. They knew. And they did exactly what we felt were the things that could get us in trouble.
Defensively, just what's your assessment on kind of where you are after 2 weeks and just kind of, you know, particularly in the first half, I thought you played well defensively, but I mean, just kind of where do you think you are defensively after 2 weeks?
Yeah, I think we're much improved. I think that, you know, I think I'm going to spin this a little bit, but I'll get back to your question. I think every turnover in football has a story to it, right? I think every big play has a story to it. They're all not the same. Yards and points defensively has stories to it as well. And I thought the story the other night was the defense fought really hard, for the most part played very hard, much more sound. We're put in some terrible situations. You know, back to the wall situations. Now, is there their job to hold them to field goals and not let them score touchdowns? Yes, and they did that for the most part. But when they don't, everybody goes, oh, gosh, look at the score. Look at, you know, and I'm like, well, you know, they got their backs put against the wall multiple times, and at some point when you're still growing as a defense, it's going to be very difficult to overcome those. This isn't the 2000 Baltimore Ravens, you know. So contextually, I thought they played pretty darn well, built off their first week's performance, and continue to get better.
In preparation for Arkansas, another road game, will there be any tweaks to the travel schedule or any adjustments made from compared to last week's?
You know, I've tried everything at this point. I thought Cole and his team did a tremendous job. I thought we traveled better than we've ever traveled. The kids were locked in. I had zero reservations going into that game on how we traveled. But, you know, I was reading something from Tony Dungy. I was texting Tony this morning about what I read. And he talks about, you know, one thing I remember about him was just consistency. Like, even when it's going bad, stay consistent to the things you know are right. And I know we traveled right. So I'm going to stay consistent to the way we traveled this week. I know it's the right way to travel. I'm not going to play the yo-yo game with them, with this group. Last year I was fine playing the yo-yo game because I didn't think they responded to anything very well. So I was kind of looking for whatever processes we felt were best. This one, I really believe in my heart, was best. The kids were, they were fantastic on a very difficult travel trip. So I don't think it had to do anything with where we travel, so we're going to stay pretty consistent with that.
Looking forward to this weekend, you guys have faced pretty good quarterbacks throughout your tenure here, but you're about to kind of go into a different animal. Can you kind of talk about Talon Green and the challenge he presents for your defense?
Yeah, tremendous player, tremendous athlete. You know, had him, it was the COVID year in Elite 11, so we only got to see him from a virtual standpoint, but we, you know, as the Elite 11 staff, we thought the world of him as a person, as a player, was successful at Boise. Totally understandable why he's with Bobby, you know. He's got everything. I mean, I didn't watch a lot of Sunday football, but I know the guy's playing on Sunday, and he looks like one of them, right? He can throw it with the best of them. He can read defenses. He's athletic. He's got physical confidence because of his skill set. He's poised. Like, he's got everything. So, tremendous shot. I mean, we're going to play an SEC team that's loaded with one of the greatest offensive minds that's ever coached football at any level, with a very talented quarterback. So, you know, you put all that together and you know, the challenge is immense, and the quarterback makes it that much more immense.
Will some guys be available this week that haven't played at all this year or maybe played limited the first 2 weeks?
We'll find out more late in the week. It's still early in the week, so from an injury and a health standpoint, there's still a lot of uncertainty. I think there's some players that have not played that are close to being ready to play. I don't want to say that on a Monday morning, you know, because I don't know yet. We're hopeful. I'd say that's the best way. We're hopeful. We're hopeful some guy that got banged up Saturday night, you know, can recover quickly.
Well, what makes Bobby Petrino such a great offensive mind? And what is he? How do you describe him? I guess
puppet master. Like, he's consistently been a puppet master offensively for years. He gets the right pieces, right? He knows what his offense needs from a skill set standpoint, and he gets them, right? And why wouldn't you go play for Bobby, right? He's got a track record of putting up massive numbers and getting guys to the NFL. So he's just it's hard not to go play for him if you're a skilled player. Then once you get there, he demands so much of your skill set, including your mind, because he wants to be the puppet master. He is the puppet master. He'll sit there and he knows the weakness of every defense, and he's going to call play because he's got an arsenal call. He's going to call play that attacks your weakness. So you constantly play you know, he does a lot like what we would like to do. We haven't been able to do it yet, but he makes you play eating your soup left-handed. You know what I mean? He's constantly putting you in a position of weakness and where you're uncomfortable. And if you're trying to play a one-high defense, he's got every one-high beater. If you're trying to play a certain front, he's got every front beater. If you're trying to, you know, take away surface players, he'll add a surface player. If you're trying to play a two-high shell, he can attack you every which way. Like, he's got an answer for everything you got. So, you know, he's Mike Martz-ish in my list of, like, innovative, creative, aggressive, attacking play callers that I've ever seen. I don't think it's an exaggeration to say he's on the Mount Rushmore of college offensive coaches.
Why is it, just in your football life, you know, not just necessarily here, but why is it difficult to win on the road? I mean, what is, you know, even in places sometimes that aren't an intimidating atmosphere, which this week will be, but, I mean, why is it difficult to win on the road?
I don't know if I answer that question, Steve, because it's different. You know, I'm only, what, 14 games into this as a college coach. And the NFL has a lot to do with crowd noise, has a lot to do with not being able to do the things you want to do because of communication. I think a lot of times you go on the road too and you try to control things you can't control. You get caught up in things you can't control. I think that disarms you. I think in high school, you're dealing with young people and just the uncomfortableness of not being at home, the lack of emotion. You know, sometimes the emotion is different at home than on the road, and this is still a passion, emotion-driven game. But in college, you know, I'm still trying to figure that out. That's why I've been a failure to this point, to be quite honest with you. I obviously have not figured it out. So I think, you know, as I'm looking at, and I'm still in process, right? Like, this is a Monday. I'm still trying to figure out a lot of the tactics for approaching this week on the road. But I think we got to get to a point where, coaches as well, we only focus on the things that we have control over. I think it really fits into that. Like, when you go on the road and you get caught up in things you can't control, then it's taking you away from your ability to be the best in the things you can control. And if we can just get to a place where we're completely committed to both mentally and physically being invested into those things that we have control over, I think we'll have better results on the road. So, but listen, it's the elephant in the room, man. It's the thing I don't sleep about. I'm trying everything I can, and at this point, I haven't been able to find the secret sauce, but I won't rest until I do.
When this is something you can't control, but when you're coming into a game with a team that lost a disappointing, you know, you're coming off a disappointing loss, but they are too. Does that affect the game at all, or does it affect the way you approach it, or you really think about how they're going to approach it?
I think all this is important, but I don't know if it's paramount. You know, I think this is one of the things that I want our building to understand, is that all what you just asked is an important category. Are they going to have a more intense week of practice? Probably. Is their messaging going to be, we got to get back on track? Probably. Are they going to find things that they need to address to get better at? Most likely. Are they going to feed off their crowd because they're at home coming off a loss on the road? Most likely. At the end of the day, does that matter more than your ability to go execute? Does that matter more than your ability to find something inside of you that's going to allow you to think clearly in the midst of chaos? Like, I don't think it does. I think you have to, again, you have to recognize the challenges. You have to recognize the things that they are going to need to bounce back from and be motivated to bounce back from. But it can't take away from your ability to maximize this week. It's amazing how much young people can change in 1 week, right? So the challenge for us is our young people and our old people too, me, need to change better in 1 week. And we got to make sure that we're using this time to become a better football team and not worry about what's going on their end. I think that's the biggest thing I've recognized in college football is so much talk is about them, whoever them is, and it distracts you from us. And in my football life, the best iterations of teams are the ones that are completely invested in us. Like, let's control us. We can't control them. Let's get become a better us. And let's see where that takes us.
Anything else?
All right, I appreciate you guys. Thank you.